energy and energy transfer. First of all, let's define a system and system boundary. Because if we want to discuss about energy and energy transfer, we have to focus on so-called a system. A system is a single object or a particle, or be a collection of objects or particles, or a region of space. So first of all, we define what is our system, then we can recognize where is the system boundary. After that, we can discuss that the environment transferred energy to the system, or the system deliver the energy to the environment. Say for example, right now we have an object of mass m, and it's on the ground. We identify this object as our system, and then we ask this question: what does the environment do to this object? As we learn from chapter 5, at least there are two forces will be on object. One is the gravity, which is mg, usually that's what we mark. And the other one is the normal force from the ground, that is F of n. So at least we have two forces on the object, that's what environment do to our system. As a matter of fact, we learn from Newton's third law. If Earth give a force to our object, which is mg, and our object will actually give a reaction back to the Earth, since the Earth is not our system that we concern, so we do not mark that reaction force. Same that when the ground support our object with Fm, as a matter of fact, the object press the ground downward. So there's a force that on the ground, same magnitude Fn, but opposite direction. For example, but we are not concerned about that force because that force is on the ground. Ground is not a part of our system. So it is very important to identify what is our system. Then we focus on the system and ask for what the environment do to the system. Next, if there is additional force, for example, we can apply a force of F, and this F, let's say, has an angle half a degree with respect to horizontal. So if this force is large enough, if it can overcome the static friction between the block of mass m and the ground, this object will start to move on the ground towards a direction. Let's say this is x equal to 0, then it will start to move. Let's define this is the positive x direction. So it will have a displacement along the positive x-axis. Well, there another force might happen because usually there is a friction between the block and the ground during the motion. That friction is kinetic friction because the two contact surfaces sliced against each other. So look at this picture of starting from force of mg, that is the force always there. Second, because this block sits on the ground, ground support the block with Fn. Third, there is a force adding to the block and dragging the block along the positive x direction. And last one, that because of a contact surface sliced against each other, and then there is kinetic friction. So our system has four forces on it. Now, obviously, when objects start to move along the x-axis, initially, if this one's velocity equal to zero, the reason the blocks start to move around the positive axis is because an acceleration. So we expect the object will pick up speed and move faster and faster. And picking up speed, moving faster, we say this object gained energy. So obviously, the environment does work to this object. So here we introduce the concept of work done. Work done by a particular force of F, defined as that force dot the displacement of the object. Well, dot actually means time, but since force is a vector, displacement is a vector, when vector times a vector, we have two different kinds of production. One is called dot production, the other is called cross production. A dot production will result a scalar product, which means F dot S comes out a number. The result is not a vector. So the work done, the amount of work done, is simply a scalar. And later, and we will learn that when a vector cross a vector, then the result will be another vector. So here, chapter 7, when we learn two vectors time each other, we call dot production, the result is a scalar. If the block moves a little distance of ds, then that little amount of work done equals to f dot ds. So let's look at this case. This is the case that we have four constant forces. So we can ask for what is the work done by each constant force. When a force is a constant, we can comfortably use this first definition, F dot S. So the work done by gravity equals to the gravity dot the displacement. Now, we haven't introduced that how do we do the calculation, but we can list all of these and we do the calculation later. And then we have that work done by this capital F, and we say that is capital F dot the displacement. And also we have that work done by a normal force that equals to Fn F dot displacement. Last one, work done by Fk equals to Fk dot displacement. So we have four forces, and we have four turns of work done. So we define total work done sigma w, and I start from 1, in our case we have 4, we add all wi, and that is work done by gravity plus work done by normal force plus work done by the dragging force plus work done by kinetic friction. Okay, so what if the work is done by a force, is not a constant? Then, starting from here, I would say the total work done equals to the summation, which is integral of F dot ds. I will show you more example for this situation later.